As Dan said, I mean, we'll have a long workshop about OSM and all the details this afternoon, so the intention is not being exhaustive on the topic, obviously, but just give you some incentives to see what is coming this afternoon. And also give you the context of why are we doing this. And I think that that is the most important takeaway of this session. So obviously, if you want to learn about the details of any community, obviously the best way is interacting with it more regularly. But if you want to know the motivations, you are looking for the motivations or signs of interest for you, for your activity and for your pain points, this is the session, okay? And hopefully this afternoon session will give you even more details on some specific aspects that can be recurring questions. So, first of all, is that the problem of orchestration sometimes is oversimplified. And you get some description of the layers, some description of the architecture of NFV, and the theory says that you have a piece that is called orchestration, NFV orchestration in this case, that does the magic trick of doing the things for you. Okay, so it looks like you have you send an order to deploy, and it somehow translates that order, splits it into a set of commands. To the virtual infrastructure manager, in this case, the BIM, that in turn will do a number of things on your behalf, deploying VMs, creating connections, and so on. Okay, that is the theory. And as you see, it's like in this situation, what we are creating a sort of BIM-dependent template, right? This is the vanilla approach to this problem. But unfortunately, this what you have in reality does not look like that. Is that after you do this, usually you need to do a number of actions afterwards to have the environment ready, up and running, and with the appropriate configuration. And that is what we see on a daily basis in the test environment. I mean, it's not a case that we are seeing in this case in Telefonica, but it's something that anyone who's been testing and validating cases finds. And it's quite frustrating. I mean, it's doable. I'm not saying it's not doable. What I'm saying is this is the exact opposite to zero touch. Actually, you have many touch points there that are not capturing that interaction for some reason. Okay. So if you are following blindly the vanilla approach, you need to make sure that you know the other things that need to be done afterwards, which is not particularly convenient. Okay, so the trick here, and I'm trying to summarize what is going wrong in this picture, is that we need to make sure that we can capture all those actions, so everything that is in this picture can be done automatically, either these actions or equivalent actions that lead to the same result. Okay, the kind of actions that I'm mentioning, I mean, changes, specific changes in the BIM, so things work as expected. Changes, even some changes in the configuration of the hardware sometimes, depending on how is the use case. We are talking about even different type of connections, even customizations of the templates. So all that is common in the commercial offers. In the current commercial offers, I mean. Is that anyone? I mean, it's not an easy problem to solve, first thing. So it's not a criticism of what's been done so far. It's that what we are trying to achieve is not trivial. It's more complicated than it seemed at first sight. So if you have a look at the global NFV architecture, and this is one of the super popular pictures in this industry, and totally successful and meaningful. The point is that if you think of it, not everything in this picture is following any standard at all, or not the kind of standards that you will, that were assumed in this picture. So if your picture does not reflect the reality, you have some problems, and you are taking some assumptions that probably are too optimistic. For instance, I mean, all this layer, the hypervisors, the beams, the SDN technologies are not following the ETSI NV standards. I mean, they have some resemblance, but their own evolution, the pace that they evolve, the new functionalities that they are incorporating, and so on, have nothing to do with the specifications there. Besides, obviously, the general framework, what are these pieces expected to do, generally speaking, but not in the every single detail that those pieces need to implement. That is simply acknowledging the situation, right? And also happens that the evolution, the pace at which these things are happening, for real, in terms of functionality, in terms of interfaces, in terms of models, has little to do with whichever that is specified in an SDO. Even more obvious is the case of the applications. The BNFs, in the end, are applications. Very specific type of applications with some special packaging, whatever. But the way that you interact with an application, and I hope that this is clear in this picture, is that even there's no convergence in the way that I can configure an application. No matter what the specification for NFV, taking the specification for NFV aside, there's no one unique way of interacting with applications. There are several approaches to interacting with applications. And you cannot say that the only approach that you will follow is based on Jang and Netcom, for instance, or is based on Ansible, or is based on Spect, or is based on something else. It's a mix of them, or even many proprietary approaches here. So it's more complicated than that. There have been many efforts in industry in general, not just in the NFV context, to try to normalize the way to interact with the BNFs. But we need to acknowledge the reality that there are several that are coexisting and have pros and cons, have some strengths, depending on which is the area where they are working. Okay. So that means that from the overall picture that we were describing at the beginning, there are not many things left for a sort of formal specification. Luckily for us, is the orchestration piece. But I mean, if you don't have control on the evolution of those layers, those pieces of the architecture, even less you have control over the evolution of those interfaces. And that's something I would say that is simply acknowledging the reality. I mean, there were some efforts, I think 2 years ago or so, on trying to normalize and standardize the normal interfaces of the beam at NFV level. But it could not lead the evolution of those. In the best case, it was possible to try to do some sort of reverse engineering of what were the solutions that were available back then. So if you are not leading in that evolution, you're in a position that has any influence, but you are just describing, then obviously you need to adopt the real thing, right? So as we see, the problem is more complicated than it seemed at the beginning. I mean, this is not one of those technologies where everything is defined in one single forum, and you go by releases describing the whole architecture and how the whole architecture works in the same manner that you do with mobile telecommunications, for instance, in general. It's more challenging than that. Actually, If you are modeling, you remember that we were modeling the reality, and that was part of the issues that we were detecting. The problem is even more complicated, because you need to make sure that your model reflects the reality. And if the reality is changing at a fast pace, you need to evolve your model at a fast pace, okay? And not in a theoretical manner, okay? So that is the actual challenge. That's the reason why we are getting that result that I described at the beginning, okay? And here's where OSM comes, right? So OSM, the central component for OSM is the information model, and everything else is derived from that. So, and OSM is all the functionalities derived from the information model inside in all the modules. We'll see that in detail this afternoon. Okay, and the point is that here we need to change the mindset from setting a specification of a whole architecture, and we should change it towards another mindset that is more, I think, more pragmatic. That is trying to interoperate with the existing technologies or technologies that are planned for the future, okay? So it's more about evolution and testing, okay? And for evolution and testing, you mostly need code, okay? So this the point is that whenever that you discover that there are things, new functionalities that need a change in your IAM, since in the case of OSM, those are percolated end-to-end across all the in internals of OSM, you can be sure that what is the effect of those changes, okay? So there's no ambiguity from that perspective. We'll talk more about adoption this afternoon, I will explain more about adoption in the particular case of Telefonica tomorrow morning in my presentation. But from an overall perspective, I think that I would want to give you an idea of what is the traction behind OSM. As of today, and maybe I'm late and I should add one additional company. We have 120 companies in OSM. Is that much or is too little? I mean, it's too much. Obviously, there are many companies, which we are really proud about the figures of membership in OSM. But it's also about the variety. In order to be able to evolve that information model in a manner that is meaningful and is practical, you need a diverse type of some very specific know-how, right, on very different fields, and we are really proud to see that we have a very diverse community. So it's not only end users, although it was initially launched by end users, service providers, but also it involves leading IT and cloud players, involves hardware makers, involves, of course, BNF vendors who obviously have their own demands and their own pain points. And I think that is awesome, because it's giving us many inputs. And actually, looking at the future, we are having, as users and also participants, many players from the academia, and many large research projects around 5G and edge technologies. So that is giving us a perspective of what is coming as well. So we are not, we are early testers of technologies that will come in 2-3 years. And that's awesome, because if your main objective is interoperability, having access to the real thing very early in the process is essential. So that is the wealth of having this large community is because of that. And actually being able to involve large players, but also small players, strong commercial companies, but more innovative type of companies, but and also even research, and I think that that is a part of the one of the key elements for the success of the project. This is an alternative view. I mean, there's an opt-in process, and when I was speaking at the beginning about the expectations of this talk, this is, so what is the commercial traction of OSM? If I had to summarize it in one slide, this is the slide. This is a totally different set of. This is about commercial offers. This is what is called the OSM ecosystem, which is equivalent to the OpenStack marketplace. I mean, in general, there are companies that are offering commercial solutions based on OSM or that interoperate with OSM. I mean, if they are selling hardware, for instance. So they interoperate with OSM and they can offer it with support. It's been an opt-in process. So this is just the tip of the iceberg, but we wanted to surface that. So the companies had even the contact point listed in our website and knew who to reach in order to test their BNFs or whatever. So and this is expected to keep growing in the future. So this is not by no means is a frozen picture. Okay, and it's not exhaustive because it's an opt-in process, but still gives the sense of actual commercial traction. Okay. So what? Right now, what I've been is describing the intentions, right, and showing that there's some interest. But actually, how does this approach, the approach of OSMs, solve this problem? So the key here is that OSM is model-centric, as I said, and here the point is that the modeling is used to hide the complexity of processes that are low-level processes that are not relevant for the operation, are relevant because they need to take place in order to do whatever that is needed, but it's not relevant from the perspective of an operator, of an user of the platform, right? We want to know all the initial red arrows that we saw at the beginning, but not the rest of the touch point, right? So the thing is that this modeling in OSM is complete, self-contained, and agnostic to the technology infrastructure. This is key because you don't need to take into account anything else in order to get your BNF or your network service up and running, and you don't need to be aware of the details, specific details of the underlying technology of the infrastructure. Okay, and here there are three different type of models. Of course, the BNF packages. This is super important. This is where all the complexity of the BNF, this is the sort of template, comes, and has two pieces. Obviously, the description of the resources that are needed, but also how to manage it. And this is the running code that is needed in order to run some actions. I'll explain in detail later on how it works. Then you have the network service package that is the composition of different networks, BNFs that play like work like the different components that you can combine and interconnect, okay? So here is what you describe that. And alternatively, you could work with a network slice, which is a kind of different animal with respect to the network service because it has some properties in terms of reusability and can work like a sort of superset of a network service. And also can have some segments that actually are network services that can be shared. I will explain this. We will see this in detail if you are still on Wednesday around. There will be one in demo about network slicing in OSM in the morning. Okay. But the thing is that here is what I get from the network function vendor Okay? And here is how I stitch it. I decide to apply to different use cases. Okay? Okay? And all this, all the life cycle is modeled. Okay? So the this is a key of the in this approach. What you, if you are a BNF vendor or a network function vendor in general, you can rest assured that if you are providing this network function package, no matter what infrastructure that I have, it will work. This is what OSN guarantees you. So if you have produced a properly built network function package, you can test it on your own with your own images. You can bring it to a larger infrastructure for testing, or you can bring it to your final customer, that the result will be the same. Okay, so if you can, you will know that if this is working here, it will end up working here. Okay, that is the strong guarantee that OSM is giving you. How does it work in practice? So as I said, at the entry point is the information model. You have some packages that you have loaded, and eventually the packages are, you need to think of the package as templates. So the package is not anything that is running. It's a sort of a template and description of what can happen in that component when you instantiate it. Okay, but in sometimes it's useful to think of the package as one of them, as the reference for an instance. Okay, so the things the following. If I load the these components into OSM, and assuming that I want to instantiate it, the thing is that in all of them, So I have here the, as I said, the description of the resources that is maybe common to all of them, and I have here the description of the management procedure. The description of the resources goes to one of the branches here, and this branch is populated with a set of connectors for different technologies, for different beams. So this gives you, since everything is described here in a technology agnostic fashion, the actual changes happen here at the connector level that is provided by OSM. So you can rest assured that even if this technology changes or this API changes eventually or evolves in the behavior in any manner, the connector provided by OSM, maintained by the own companies who are supplying the BIM technology, the behavior will be consistent. And no matter if you are working in a private cloud or a public cloud, if you are working with one technology or another, the behavior will be the one that you are expecting. Okay? So the BIM will do on your behalf all the deployment, connection, etc., etc. This is what happens in this branch. In the other branch, what you take the other part, management procedures that come here, and here you have the other big trick that is played in OSM. That is essentially it's a sort of a plugin model, a generic plugin model for the application, which is the charms, and actually the running what is called proxy charms. What are we doing here? As I said, is code, actually. What I have here is captured a set of actions that I can trigger into those service objects. And what this says, what is embedded here, is the code to implement those actions southbound. I mean, the interaction, the specific protocol that is spoken here, is totally irrelevant from OSM perspective. OSM is not mandating you to use one specific protocol here. That is implemented in the code here. That southbound interaction is implemented and is bundled in your package. Of course, there are enablers, something that is called layers that are sort of libraries provided by OSM to facilitate this effort. So BNFs that have a southbound protocol in common, you don't need to implement it from scratch necessarily. Okay? But the framework allows you to add as any kind of southbound interaction that you might possibly need. Okay. What I have here is a container running the code here and implementing these actions. And of course, there are some rules. There's the only a request here, the only requirement is that you report to the rest of OSM, to the rest of OSM, you report that you are doing well. I mean, I'm starting this BNF, so you report that it's being successful or not, or you are progressing or whatever. Okay, that is the only restriction. So with this framework, is how we do the trick. And another thing that I did not mention, but is relevant from this perspective, is that I have not, although we are implicitly talking about BNFs, if we are talking about physical network function, or library network function, the picture does not change much, because from this perspective, this, if thinking of a physical network function, this branch is simply idle in OSM. You don't use it, but you keep using this BNF. So from this perspective, the package does not change substantially, besides telling that this BNF is not a BNF, it's something physical. Okay? So that is the beauty of the current framework in OSM. So in the end, what we are getting as a result, we are getting a platform that is working, that is providing networks as a service, is what we have. And this platform is using services provided by virtual domains, I mean BIMs, but also transport domains, wide area networks, and of course interacting with the network functions, whether they are physical, virtual, or hybrid, a mix of them. Okay? And what OSM is provided on demand are networks that are created out of this process. So that is what OSM, and OSM is not providing, does not aim to provide anything else, okay? Because this is more than sufficient from the perspective of a scope, okay? And of course, it's taking advantage of this layered approach in order to decompose the problem in simpler problems. Once that, the last piece of information here is that once that I have an instance of a network service or an slice, then OSM provides the ability to run actions on it. So you don't need to know the details of every single component inside that network service. You can interact with the network service as a whole, as a single object, end to end. Okay, so that is one of the strengths of this. So, of course, if you want to interact with each of the components, that is doable, that is possible, but it's not the most convenient way of using it. So OSM facilitates that. So you can interact with the network service as it is, as it were, and actually is a first-class citizen in OSM. It's a network provided as a service. Okay. The last point that I wanted to make is that, I mean, if you analyze the process of onboarding of a BNF, this is one source of a terrible source of inefficiency in industry. So that if you analyze the process of the onboarding of a BNF, most of the effort is on reverse engineering, on trying to figure out how the BNF works. I mean, and actually, almost everything that is Martin Green is about understanding concepts. It's not about coding, it's not about creating any model. It's about of trying to figure out how that network function, how that application behaves. Well, it should be something well known by the developer, I guess, right? Only this piece is what is actually the onboarding. But most of the effort and most of the time, I would say, in an 80 versus 20, or even more, this balance is spent here today. And even the process is not totally successful. So the advantage of having a well-known information model publicly shared and testable on your own is that you can incorporate this process in early stages in the process in a convenient manner for the developer. So the developer can rest assured that anything that, that is testing even locally or in their CI/CD or whatever will end up working. So they can incorporate these models for their own benefit because it makes their life easier. Okay, and that is how we are spending a lot of time in trying to enable the ecosystem to learn about this, because of course we can onboard every single BNF today, and that's fine, that is what we are doing, but there's a further advantage of having a well-known information model and incorporating it during the early development process. That is that you are saving all this effort, because it's implicit, it does not exist, and you go straight at development phases here, and it facilitates your own work, your own testing, and you can rest assured that as a side effect of this process, you have a working network function package that you can commercialize, and it's ready for any infrastructure, commercial infrastructure in the world. So that is the advantage of having a well-known information model that can be tested and validated and incorporated to the process. Okay. So some key takeaways. So what OSM provides, whenever that you are hearing someone trying to explain OSM and you see that it's super complicated, perhaps. I mean, there are many details, and you'll see a lot of the details this afternoon in the workshop. But if you need to summarize what OSM does in a sentence, is that it provides networks as a service. It's what it does. And it uses virtual components, physical components, long-distance communications on demand. Okay, it's with a large set of technologies, but it's what it does. Okay, and there are no fundamental differences in that perspective from virtual or physical components. Okay, actually, in most practical cases, you have a combination of them. OSM is not asking you to use any specific protocol to interact southbound with your applications, with your network function, or even with your bin or your one. It's not mandating that. On the other side, it gives the freedom and the tooling as well to use a large set of different component protocols in different components belonging to the same network service. Okay. As a result, if you are playing according to the rules of the game, you're getting an advantage that you don't need whenever you produce a package for that it works with OSM, it will work in any infrastructure. And that is what OSM will guarantees you. And it's future proof, because that is supported even in the evolution of those technologies. There's already a market of offers based on OSM, based on these premises that I've described. So this is not future thinking, it's what we are seeing now, but trying to make it more visible now. And of course, one as a reflection, having a well-known information model, having all these type of guarantees on usability, is also can be also incorporated at early stages of the development. So you minimize the potential of reverse engineering, even in the field. I mean, because it's even in the same company that the field engineer needs to do a lot of reverse engineering, as you know, sometimes. So this even is a way, or provides an effective mean to encapsulate knowledge in a package and make it running code. So there's no ambiguity even in that change, even if it's in the same company, it facilitates precisely that. Okay. And that's all that I have. If you have, you want more information, you are kindly invited to see the presentation from Vanessa later in the morning, and of course attend the OSM workshop this afternoon. If you are interested in commercial adoption, tomorrow morning there will be one presentation, in this case on behalf of Telefonica, what is the plans and how this intersects in our architecture, which has its particularities, and also you want to see in motion how this works in practice. There will be a session this Wednesday. Okay.
Questions for clarification?
Yeah.
So you mentioned PNFs, VNFs, and HNFs, physical, virtual, and hybrid network functions. You didn't mention CNFs, containerized network functions. Do you care, or are they equally admissible into the OSN ecosystem?
Yeah, that's a good question. Actually, we'll spend some time this afternoon talking about the Kubernetes in OSM. Yes, that's a good point. That actually, there's no fundamental difference in this framework in the support of Kubernetes. There are no big changes with this is more a technicality than actually the any change in the framework. But yes, obviously it's relevant. The thing is that as always, you need to map it to the current technology, and we've been working for, I would say this is the third release where we've been working around Kubernetes in OSM. We felt in the past that it was not ready yet, not only in our approach to Kubernetes, but also in the way that that were things that might be inconsistent in Kubernetes as well. There were no commercial offers to start with. So there were few, besides the theoretical interest around Kubernetes, there was no traction in terms of VNFs that could be used for that purpose. Now there are some commercial offers around Kubernetes, so now probably is the right time. And I think that, I mean, the good news is that we have completed a design based on that already. Probably for the upcoming release would be a bit early, because I mean we want to do it right. If we release it, we release it in with some, I would say, with some guarantees that it will behave as we want. So maybe during in the launch of the next release, maybe it won't be one of the things that are announced, but it's one of the top priorities in OSM, because we have spent a significant amount of effort, and we want to make sure that when we release it, the experience is awesome, as we always want. Okay, but from this perspective, just to clarify, the case of Kubernetes looks like a VNF, because you need both branches to work in a different order with a set of steps back and forth between them, but essentially is the same thing. Okay?
The same line. So you mentioned VNFs and PNFs. They are generic statements. How would you differentiate Cisco VNF and a Juniper VNF or a Palo Alto VNF? Because you're spending them just considering their VNF, but eventually they are proprietary VNFs, if I'm right. So how does OSM talk to these proprietary VNFs in terms of spinning them up, in terms of configuring them? Because they all support different protocols.
Mm-hmm.
And they have all the different sort of... So how does OSM structure different vendors?
Okay, so I'll come back to this picture then. Yeah, the thing is that each VNF has their own package. So is obviously we are not mandating Cisco and Juniper to converge in the way that they is the other way around. This is what we are providing the means to encapsulate the different management the different management procedures, which means different southbound implementations from OSM that are embedded here. So we are not mandating to Cisco or to Juniper to use different configuration methods or same configuration methods. They look alike sometimes, by the way, but and that is something that we play in our advantage, providing the layers and libraries that can be common or can be reusable somehow between the different to build these packages. Okay, but that is not the critical thing. The thing is that we are providing the freedom to bring different packages for different VNFs. So there would be a package for the Cisco router of X size and another package for the equivalent sizing in Juniper, for instance.
Who is this being provided? I mean, who is this lead? This is the consulting? So let's say if a service provider has a deployment and he's got XYZ vendor in this case, four or five of them, And as I understand, you will need a customized SDI Salvone package so that OSM can work with this environment. So who would provide that package?
The VNF vendor.
The VNF vendor?
Yeah. Actually, that is what, this is not new in the case of OSM. It's simply that it's incorporating more stuff. But, I mean, if you go to a...
So the Nano consortium will not support that because there will be a level of integration required between Nano tool as well as the VNS. So VNF provider can provide, let's say, a plugin or something, but someone from orchestration space needs to kind of support that.
No, it's the other way around. Probably I did not explain well. Is the other way around. Is that you are when you are creating an application, you are providing the means to interact with it. The client application, I mean, it's simply that. So that client application is embedded there. That's it. Actually, this is sounds more complicated than it is in practice. Is that in brownfield, sometimes you need to create the package yourself. Okay. With the support of the vendor, but because they don't have the skills or whatever. But in most of the cases, it's not about OSM. It's about having the vendor the ability to create a script to support one operation. That is, those scripts are the ones that are embedded here. In a more sophisticated fashion, but essentially it's creating a sort of script that is consistent for each of the that's it. And no matter if it's supported by one type of protocol or the other, it's orthogonal to this conversation. We only providing the vehicle to embed that in a well structured way to embed that information. That's all. And actually, something that I did not mention: we are not even opinionated about the language of that code. It's in the own execution environment, so I'm not saying that it must be Python. And Python has some advantages because most of the libraries that we are providing are based on Python. But I mean, if you do it in Bash, it works. I mean, so it's not, or in C++, because you add it already. If you add it already, you add an element manager already, or some prototype of element manager or whatever. That is what you will embed there. So it's a way of providing a structure and a way of providing that information. That's all.